Well, good morning. I'm not sure why I was invited here at all, quite honestly. My medical profession is surgery, so surgeons are not known to develop drugs. They are using very important tools to remove lesions or to repair lesions, but nothing, almost nothing to do with drugs. And my biology background is very different from personalized medicine because it's longitudinal. For all my career, I was interested in one single reaction, though the system that we discovered is a huge system. It comprises about 10% of the human genome. And the drugs that were developed based on it, of course, are encountering the same problems that we are seeing today. Some of the patients respond, some don't respond, some respond only partially, some develop side effects, and the question is why. But we are not there yet, at least in my lab. We are very deep underneath the ground, studying still basic mechanisms. So why I'm here? Maybe because of my hobby. My hobby is history and philosophy of medicine, and so I'll try to share with you my own view and taking a very different point of view than the one presented by the previous speakers. It will be a mix of historical, ethical, and so on and so forth, rather than going into single-cell transcriptomics or epigenetic analysis of tumors. So what about personalized medicine? I think that it's kind of a showcase. You know, we put this term in a kind of a glass case, and there are commercial interest here of companies and so on and so forth. And at the end, we shall take from it whatever we can take from it and move on with other technologies as well. And we should remember that medicine is not only about drugs. Medicine is also about engineering of tissues, stem cells, and so on. Medicine is also about devices. The importance of devices have shown itself in a very strong way from in cardiology, in orthopedics, and so on and so forth. It's also diagnostics and imaging and so on and so forth. So, you know, we have to look at things from a broad perspective. But let's look a little bit about life today. And think about 120 years ago. 120 years ago, the lifespan was about 50, 55 years. People died of infections. Women died at delivery. Farmers died in the farm from tetanus and so on and so forth. And something happened in the 20th century that added about 30, 35 years to our lifespan. It's amazing. It took 4,000 years to the old Greeks and Egyptians to add 20 years, 4,000 years, to add 20 years to lifespan. And in one single century, about 2.5% of the time that we are following history more or less in detail, we added another 30 years, 25 years, and we are still climbing up. And what is it about? It's about medicine, science, and technology. It's about antibiotics and vaccination and imaging from X-ray to CT scan to MRI. So it has not been that bad. And the question is whether the trend is going to continue, how much we are going to add and at what price, whether there is a limit. There is a big discussion about it, whether there is an age limit. There was a Nature paper about 2 years ago about that the age limit will be 115. And we shall succumb to an avalanche of mutations. But then CRISPR comes, so we may be able to edit it. So we really don't know. We cannot really predict, but it's very interesting. Also, think about it. All the problems that we are discussing in personalized medicine are what I call new diseases. Because 100 years ago, people did not die of cancer because they didn't live long enough to get cancer. Think about it, cancer is an age-dependent, a bona fide age-dependent disease. Yes, there is cancer in childhood, there is cancer in the young age. I know the data, I happen to be the president of the Israel Cancer Society, but it's about 2 to 3% until the age of 35, 40, and then it starts to a very slow incidence is growing exponentially. Patients didn't die of heart and vascular diseases about 120 years ago, exactly from the same reason. They didn't live long enough. And the same from brain diseases. If you are thinking about vascular diseases, malignancies, and brain diseases, these are the main killers of modern society, and they are all kind of new diseases that evolved in the last century, and we are dealing with them now under the scope of this conference, but in general in medicine. That's what bothers biomedical research and physicians and patients nowadays, the big three killers. Of course, we are neglecting whole continents. We are neglecting Africa. We are neglecting some underdeveloped countries that people are still dying of infectious diseases, of malaria, and so on and so forth. Also diseases that have not found a solution, but maybe from other reasons, more from economic reasons than from scientific reasons. So let's talk about what happened until now. So until now, there were also revolutions or development. So the first revolution was a kind of incidental discoveries. You know, people didn't even mean to develop a drug, and a drug somehow showed up, and blockbuster drugs came to the market completely by coincidence. So think about aspirin. Aspirin, which is probably the drug that is being used by tons, more than any other drug in the pharma history, came to the world because of the old Egyptian 4,000 years ago. They noted that by chewing the leaves of the willow bark that grew on the banks of the Nile River, the taste was awfully bitter, but it alleviated pain, and they reported about it. Then only at the end of the 19th century, the beginning of the 20th century, French and German scientists took it back, isolated the material that is called salicin, acetylated it, took away the bitter taste, but didn't remove the pain alleviating characteristics. And then there was a very interesting history that has to do with Jewish and German history. Eichengrun, a pharmacist at Bayer, and then Felix Hoffmann, the picture of whom you see here, tried to treat a patient with rheumatoid arthritis. They synthesized the drug in the basement, and lo and behold, they saw that not only the pain goes away, but also the inflammation goes away. And they said, wow, we discovered an anti-inflammatory drug. They went to Bayer, and Bayer adapted it and started the mass production. And aspirin has been used forever. And then aspirin has undergone many revolutions. One of them was only at the 80s of the last century, of the famous 20th century, when the anticoagulation activities of aspirin came to the knowledge, or people discovered it, and then it became the drug of choice to prevent myocardial infarction, second myocardial infarction, which is coagulation of blood in the coronary arteries. Then, only a few years ago, the anti-inflammatory characteristics came to the attention of people, and aspirin became so-called, still with many doubts, but there are some very strong studies showing it, and a chemopreventive drug, especially for patients that have a family history, especially in colorectal carcinoma. So you prevent inflammation, and by that you prevent also malignant transformation. So aspirin, from becoming anti-feverish and anti-pain, became anti-coagulation, and then anti-inflammatory and anti-cancer, and so on and so forth. And it's probably, as I said, the drug that has been used and still being used and increasingly being used more than any other drug in the history of the pharma. Complete coincidence, almost not a penny invested. Another drug that came by coincidence is penicillin, the first antibiotic. We cannot imagine the world without antibiotics. Nowadays, with all the problems of development of resistance and so on and so forth, it was the little petri dish that Sir Alexander Fleming grew in. He was an English microbiologist that grew in the lab, forgot open for the weekend, came back, the famous story, the dish is still in the British Museum. And you can see that he smeared the bacteria here is the mouse. But you can see that during the weekend, a spore of a fungus fell on the dish, grew along the weekend. And when he came after a few days, he noted this contamination, but he also noted a little halo that separated between the bacteria and the fungal colony to which bacteria couldn't go in. And he surmised that there is a material that was secreted by the fungi, which he called antibiotics, anti, against, life, bios. It took him, he was not a biochemist, and then Sir Ernst Chain and Howard Florey came to the story, and the three of them won the Nobel Prize in 1945. And the first antibiotic was already saved the lives of hundreds of thousands of of soldiers during World War II. And then, of course, an avalanche started. Selman Waksman discovered streptomycin because he realized that bacteria are secreting antibiotics as a means to defend themselves against fungal, that fungi secrete antibiotics as a means to defend themselves against bacterial attack. So, and now we are doing them synthetically and so on and so forth. But the beginning was completely coincidental. Just mentioned that a drug to develop today, to bring a drug to the market, is something in the range of 10 or so billion dollars. Here, nothing was invested. We didn't call it a revolution, but it was a revolution. It's just a matter of semantics. Then came the second revolution, and the second revolution was a revolution of high throughput. And the high throughput actually is a wedding, is a matchmaking between a bride and a bridegroom that were not supposed to get married, but nevertheless they did get married. On one hand, the development of disease models, let it be mostly tissue culture. So people were able to eternalize cells in the dish, which is very easy. You just now we know that it's very easy. So this is the bride or the bridegroom, depends on the eyes of the beholder. The other part was the development of chemistry. You know, synthetic organic chemistry really flourished along the 50s and 60s and 70s and still nowadays. And people have numerous intermediates that they didn't know what to do until they get, you know, from time to time. Take, for example, the anti-malarial drug artemisinin. You need about 70 steps of synthesis in order to get it. So along the steps, you have intermediates. And then you have the final product. And at the end, the final product doesn't work. So you have some drugs that are sitting there, or repurposing of drugs that are already in use for something, and then you want to repurpose them for something else. And we know many of them, thalidomide, for example, in multiple myeloma, and so on and so forth. So the matchmaking was, okay, let's go and screen. We have no idea about the mechanism, but somehow the structure of the target protein will fit into one of the million compounds that we shall test, and we shall have an effect. This is not a drug yet. This is just the very beginning. A long way is starting, initially getting leads and then going to phase one, toxicity, phase one, phase two, phase three, and so on. Most of them fail. But it's a brute force screening with no mechanism in mind. And many drugs came to the market, many very successful drugs, including not Gleevec, but including many kinase inhibitors for cancer. They did come to the market. One drug that I like a lot is, of course, statins. Statins is also a multi-billion dollar sales drug. It's an inhibitor of HMG-CoA reductase, the first rate-limiting enzyme in the biosynthesis of cholesterol. And it came by Akira Endo, who screened a small library, about 50,000 compounds of plant products, Japanese plant compounds. And he found one of them. He put a very cumbersome assay. The output assay was very cumbersome. It was a radioactive assay for biosynthesis of cholesterol, doesn't matter. And he found one compound. It was the late 60s, early 70s. And this was the first statin. And then it was taken by Park Davis and by other companies. Now we have very sophisticated statins and so on and so forth. So it came by screening and, as I said, many others. But then people realized that we all realized that drugs are not the drugs that are developed on models, either on tissue culture and even on patients in phase three clinical trials are not good enough because some of the patients, as I said, respond. Some respond partially. Some develop side effects. Some develop side effects and respond. And then the question is the severity of the side effect. Actually, about between 6 1/4 of patients in American hospitals are suffering severe adverse drug reactions, including fatalities. So the problem is a huge problem. The drug, what they call the ADR, the adverse drug reactions, are really a major, major problem, and we cannot predict them. I remember myself as a kid, I was asked when I got to the emergency room, got wounded, I don't know what, whether you are sensitive to penicillin. That's all what they knew to ask. And basically today, they don't ask much more sophisticated whether I know some sensitivity in the family. But we really don't know what's going on there. We are really very primitive in our approach about side effects. And then, of course, came another development, and that's, I think that April 2000, with the unraveling of the human genome, I remember very well the excitement, the New York Times covering article on the Nature paper. It was one of the April issues of Nature. The human genome was sequenced, and everybody thought, wow, that's it. We are done. Everything will be solved very quickly. But as happens again, it's a pendulum that moves from the right side to the left side. But at the end, it will get to the right place. And then came, of course, the Lee Hood terminology, that it's not only personalized or precise in the language of President Obama, but it's also predictive, because we can now at least partially predict. It's therefore preventive, because some of the diseases can be preventive, or at least we can follow up susceptible patients. And it's participatory. And the participatory is one part that I want to really emphasize in my talk, because that has to do with the bioethical issues that are being opened in a big way, and very little attention is being paid to them. So these are the four or five P's of the personalized medicine revolution. But we didn't call it with the other two development, the incidental one. Well, incidental is incidental. We cannot rely on incidents. But the screening was kind of a systematic approach. It took us time to discover that this is not the story, that mouse is not a model, that inbred mouse that eats chow purina, and we turn the light on at 8 o'clock in the morning and we turn the light off at 8 o'clock in the evening, is not the right model animal. And the right model animal is, of course, the human being, but we cannot experiment human beings. So we have to approach human being in a different way. And the different way was opened. So that's all what it is about. We didn't call the previous development revolution, and we shouldn't call personalized medicine a revolution. It's yet another technological development. That's all what it is. And of course, we thought that it's all in the genomics, but we just heard it's not in the genomics. It's in the gene, but it's above the gene. It's in the microRNA, and it's in the RNA, and it's in the epigenetic changes in the DNA, and it's in the proteins. And proteins are undergoing multiple post-translational modifications, and which may be called epigenetic or post-translational, doesn't matter how we call it. And it's the whole story, and the realization that the story is much more complicated than genomics led to the development push technology. Technology and needs are always going like a cogwheel. The need leads to the development of technology, and then the technology solves one problem, and then another need is coming, and that's how we move. So the whole omics develops, and we are unfortunately, or fortunately, depends again how we look at it. The language of DNA is extremely simple. It's only four letters, and the molecule is kind of robust, so we don't have to treat it gently. RNA is much more sensitive, so it needs a little bit more care. And the post-translational modifications of proteins are still not there. We are there, but not there yet as far as sensitivity is concerned. But proteomics is moving very fast, and I think that every 2 years we are moving by one order of magnitude to really sequence again, or to look into the entire proteome and changes in the proteome with all the post-translational modification. So the need really pushed the technology, and that's what all personalized medicine is all about, at least in my eyes. And I think that if we shall adopt this kind of terminology, then I think the things about success and failure and challenges, we should realize them, and we should handle them. But I think that we can do it more calmly, and approaching it with much more reasonable and rational tools. So, of course, we are different from one another. Actually, I think that there are not, maybe the epigeneticist will correct me. I don't think that there are two people that walk on the face of Earth that are identical to one another. Of course, not even identical twins, epigenetics and so on. So there are not two people that walks, and therefore no wonder that we are responding to drugs and to treatments very differently. So let's now just go very quickly to the problems. What are really the challenges? This is not an exhaustive list, but rather a very limited list, and we saw some of the problems that were raised by previous speakers. And as I said, some of the problems are technological, and some of the problems are ethical. I believe that at the long range, the technological problems will be solved. The systems are extremely complex, especially in certain diseases where there is not one gene. I remember myself as a medical student. I remember the the textbook of Stanbury, the genetic, the metabolic basis of genetic diseases, the logo was one gene, one disease. And of course, these days are completely over, and there are many genes that are contribute to the pathology, and each contribute quantitatively a different factor. It's only the cumulative effect of all these factors, and it's very difficult nowadays to assess the contribution of each factor, especially in complex diseases like psychological diseases, psychiatric diseases, like now people are now talking a lot about the autism spectrum. We don't even understand what is autism. It's a whole spectrum of diseases, and we don't know even how to stratify it yet as far as definition of symptoms is concerned. So as I said, many diseases are multigenic. That makes things much more complicated. You know, we are all talking about cancer, because cancer is relatively, I wouldn't say easy to approach, but it's a very well-studied disease with many advances that have been made in recent years. And it's always a mutation, so we always look at the genes. But those diseases are far more complex than cancer, and we haven't even started approaching them as far as analysis is concerned. So this is one obstacle, of course, the complexity. And not to say, of course, the complexity of cancer itself, as was presented in the two previous talks. Now, on top of it, malignancies are characterized. One of the hallmarks of malignancies are, of course, a genomic instability. So we see at the beginning one cell. We don't see one cell. We typically catch the disease later. But it starts with one mutation, and then other mutations do develop, and they do develop even more so under the pressure of the treatment. And then, therefore, nobody illuses himself or herself anymore that cancer will need multiple treatments. There will be not now very few cancers today that are treated with a single drug, if I'm not wrong, ovarian, a testicular cancer with methotrexate, premyelocytic leukemia with two drugs, and so on and so forth, but very few of them. And the rest need the multiple drug approach. Then, of course, human experimentation is extremely complex. Think about, we cannot even get to a conclusion about whether aspirin is good to prevent a second myocardial infarction or not. We need huge meta-analysis, and even there, think about a hormonal replacement therapy for menopausal women. We have no conclusion. When, at the end of the day, we leave it to the family, to the patient, to decide what to do, because there is not, you know, we need huge experimentation and which are cost enormous amount of money in order to get to a conclusion about a single drug. So human experimentation is extremely, and then of course we are lacking faithful animal models, especially in psychological, psychiatric diseases. And then legal liability of the companies makes them very sensitive. They don't go to certain areas. For example, antibiotics, they are not interested. Companies are being driven. This is another issue, which actually belongs also to the bioethical issues that I wanted to discuss. You know, biopharmaceutical companies, they have a board of directors, they have a CEO, and at the end of the year, they want to see their share up. That's the only thing that they are interested. They develop drug according to market need in developed countries, not in developing countries. So antibiotics, you should invite next year Ada, Yona, to tell you about how poor is the development of antibiotics by companies, because antibiotics, people, it's not a chronic drug. People take it for 10 days until the infection is over. Anyway, the shelf lifetime of an antibiotic is limited because some resistant bug will be developed in a few years, and the investment is not worthwhile for them. So the antibiotic pipeline is basically almost dry. So the companies are, so maybe this is a reason why, you know, maybe government should be intervene here, either subsidize or, you know, the government is responsible for education, is responsible for welfare, is responsible for defense. Why not the government is responsible for health? But they're responsible for health in developing infrastructure, in educating physicians, in developing hospitals. Why shouldn't they be responsible for drug development when it's becoming a sole commercial interest? So this is just one point to think of. And the companies have their own interest, and as I said, they are susceptible to legal suit and so on and so forth. And for them, it's also the end of the blockbuster era. So think about statins. Until very recently, statin was the only drug to reduce cholesterol. Now we have a second antibody. which is still not in the Israeli basket, health basket. It will become the PCKS9, which is a very efficient drug for extreme hypercholesterolemic patients. But many of them don't benefit from statins, and many develop side effects, muscular side effects, and so on and so forth. But for the company, it's great because it's a blockbuster. Once we shall start to stratify the hypercholesterolemia to the different reasons, to the different underlying mechanisms, then it will become a problem because the blockbuster era will end for them. The multi-billion dollar sale will end, and they will have to not only to develop new drugs, which each will cost them so much, but also the market share of each drug will be only a slice of the market, unlike now. And the same for many other drugs that are blockbuster drugs. Think about chemotherapy. There are many chemotherapeutic drugs in the market, but still the number is limited. The number is limited, and they are all blockbuster drugs. Each of them, when the company develops, brings to the market the new chemotherapeutics, they are talking about billions of dollars in yearly sales. So they are all blockbuster drugs. Once we shall start to identify mechanisms, the market will be sliced. Think about breast cancer. That was sliced only, we heard about tamoxifen this morning. It's tamoxifen for estrogen, and then for the progesterone, and then the EGF receptor, and then the triple negative, and then the triple negative at the end, we shall understand the triple negative. So it will have something behind it, and the market is going, each disease is going slowly to be sliced into sub-mechanisms, and so on and so forth. But the bioethical issues are really heavy, and I think that this is part of the discussion and the scope of this meeting. I just mentioned yesterday we had a roundtable discussion about and that goes well beyond personalized medicine, because if we have to cure a patient, then the roads should be open. We should have access to all the information. But then, what happens to this information? And many things can happen to this information. A few months ago in San Francisco, a serial murderer was caught based on DNA analysis. It was an unbelievable detective story. I'm sure that it will be filmed one day. A week ago in Jerusalem, a murderer of Noah Eyal was caught, Daniel Nachmani, again based on DNA analysis. Started with his father that was arrested for something else. The DNA was taken from him, was sitting in the storage for 7 years. And then all of a sudden the police started to look for comparison, and they compared all the data in the bank, and the son came up and they started to follow up. They collected the sputum, but then they suspected that the sputum may be contaminated with the sputum that was anyway on the pavement. And then they arrested him and took a sample, and that's it. And then they brought all the other evidence. So, think about it. Well, in this case, of course, everybody will justify it. It's to arrest a serial murderer or a cruel, unbelievable, cruel rapist and murderer. So that's justified. But then there is no limit. You know, the slope is extremely, extremely slippery. Think about an emergency room that the patient is coming in the afternoon with a chest pain. And they do biochemistry, they do the typical biochemistry, they find cholesterol, they try to rule out heart attack, they do all the sophisticated examinations to rule a heart attack between enzymes and ECG and all kinds of biomarkers. And then they do also sequencing. I think that sequencing will become very soon kind of a routine like we do until now, typical biochemistry between sodium, potassium, phosphate, bilirubin, alkaline phosphatase, and other enzymes. Sequencing will become, or at least partially, routine, and then you are discovering a gene, a mutation in gene. Can be a mutation in Parkin that is involved in Parkinson, can be a mutation in APOE4BA that is involved in high susceptibility to Alzheimer's. Then what do you do with the information? First of all, how do you store it? How do you secure it? And then what do the patient do with the information? You know, it starts with family members, with the wife and with the children that may carry the gene. Then it goes to the employer that may not be happy about it. Then it goes to the insurance agent that may not be happy about it. And then what is the limit of what's going on? So the protection of privacy becomes a major, major issue. And even if the privacy is protected, are we supposed to hide information from certain people? if you are asked whether you know that there is something, what do you say if you do know something and you want to hide it, and so on and so forth. So as you see, it's going well beyond the cure of the patient, the fitting of a drug to the appropriate disease. And that has to do with the predictive part of personalized medicine, one of the P's, and also with the participatory. So what is the participatory? The participatory is the fact that the patient from now on, unlike until now, or partially until now, has to participate in the decision-making process regarding his fate. I remember in the 60s and the 70s when I was a medical student, the patient didn't even dare to ask, not that he didn't know. The doctor was such an authority, he was next to God. Trust me, I'm your doctor. Don't bully me with all your questions. And there were no questions, actually, because we knew very little. Now there is an internet and lawyers and flood of information. The patients are coming educated and for the good so. And we need to dialogue with the patients. And the doctor takes a side step. He becomes kind of a consultant, a professional consultant. But he's not the one to impose. And it depends, of course, on the understanding of the patient. Not all the patients understand the problem to the same extent, and so on and so forth. So medicine is becoming extremely, extremely complicated. I still don't see medical schools taking up the challenge. They do not take up the challenge. They are still busy with anatomy and histology and embryology and internal medicine, and so on and so forth. 6 years are packed with material. And we don't have the time for that, but it's time to think about it. Here and there, there is some course in ethics and so on and so forth, but it's like a drop in the bucket. We should take it much more seriously. The attitude to the patient. How do we talk to the patient about any disease now? It can be hypercholesterolemia. It can be future Alzheimer's. It can be anything. We don't learn how to talk to patients. So this is a truly a major issue. And I think that I want to end up just raising a discussion. I'm not bringing any solution. This is coming up all the time, the issue of genetic privacy. You know, you can read and read on it endlessly. I mean, it's in the big journals, you can read, and we are not ready for that. We don't know what's going to happen to our information. And of course, Angelina Jolie, I think, typifies or exemplifies the best in the best way, what is personalized medicine or stratified medicine. I don't want to confuse between the two terms. There will be a discussion of this by Hans Lehrach later on. What does it mean? Well, she suspected, you all know, that she's a carrier of the BRCA1 gene because her mother died of breast cancer, her aunt, the sister of the mother, died of ovarian cancer. The story was known. And she was courageous enough to go and do 2 removals of her ovaries and her breast, and to go to the public, to tell the public, beware of. It's amazing, again, how cultural issues are affecting such a knowledge. So in the American society, the number of total radical mastectomies, well, it's maybe not the right term. Nir, you should educate me about it. I don't know about what is the right term, because my radical mastectomy was used to people used to use for breast cancer, but that's preventive mastectomy and even ovariectomy. The number of operations in the United States kind of went up enormously, many fold. In Israel, silence, complete silence. Though people know about it, and the Israel Cancer Society talk about it. Not that I encourage operations, but I think that either the Jews or the Israelis, I don't know, they are more risk takers. They are believers in whatever they believe. And complete silence, the number of operations went up by a fraction of percent. Again, it just shows you, without judging either society, I'm not going into any judgment, it just shows you that another obstacle is, of course, a cultural obstacle, religious obstacle, historical obstacle. So it's not, we are really facing a major, major problem in not only in the technological implementation, which may be the easy part, but conveying it to the public and educating the public about the meaning behind this revolution. As I said, for the technological problems, I'm quite optimistic. There should be no technology that should be beyond our reach, maybe not in our generation, but think about the exponential development in technology. And I always compare, if I have to think of the 20th century in big achievement in biomedical sciences, I think that the single discovery that really pops up is the double helix. There is no doubt about it. Think about it. What did the double helix do to us? From mutagenesis to everything, cloning, understanding. It's probably the discovery that expanded in the most stormy way than any other discovery in biomedical sciences. I'm not familiar with physical or chemical sciences, but think about the discovery of the double helix. Let's just end up with an optimal notion. And the optimal notion, again, the technology will overcome it. Think about CRISPR. CRISPR is behind the corner. We shall be able to correct, to edit it, with all the moral issues. We just heard about the experiment in China, in Shenzhen, about correcting two babies, trying to make them AIDS resistant. Let's don't talk about it even, but the technology is behind the corner. I think that whatever the new revolution, the new development, if we shall abandon the term personalized medicine, we may be better off. The new development promising to be more precise, with less side effects, and with better efficacy. And again, it will be part of an armamentarium. Let's don't put all our hopes into it. It will be part of a very broad armamentarium. We are not giving up old medicine. We are not giving up other technologies that will join in the mainstream in order to improve our lives. Thank you very much.